Good morning, everyone. I'm sorry for being 1 minute and 16 seconds late. We were just discussing something earlier. Thank you all very much for coming here today to the Social Security Committee. I just want to say welcome to the visitors as well as the people who are giving evidence, and kind of remind everyone to turn off their mobile phones as they do interfere with the sound system in the committee. Agenda item one is decision on taking business in private. Our first item here is to whether we take agenda items three and four in private. Is that acceptable to the members? Thank you very much. Agenda item two is a main agenda item today, and this is an evidence session on the rollout of universal credit. And can I welcome our witnesses here today? Rob Gowans, Policy Officer of Citizens Advice Scotland. Archie Campbell, Benefits Representative, Musselburgh Citizens Advice Bureau. And it would be over the page. Kynia Reeves, Individual Advocacy Worker, CAPS Independence Advocacy. I'll just open it up to questions if you don't mind. You don't have any opening statements. That's absolutely wonderful. I'll ask the first couple of questions, just sort of a probing questions, and if you could answer, please, and other members no doubt will come in. I just wondered if you agree with the principles of universal credit and whether you feel that in practice universal credit is a positive change for claimants. So whoever wants to answer first. Mr. Campbell.
In principle, yes. But it's so far removed from the principle, even as they envisaged it when they introduced it. They've been tweaking with it ever since. For instance, one of the policy statements in the introduction was, and it was on their website, simplifying the benefit system and making work pay. Now, I noticed they've taken that down from the website because, quite frankly, it's a bad joke, because neither of these statements are correct. They've withdrawn most of the work allowances. The rest of them, apart from one, which is somebody who is on, who's got limited capability for work, they still get the same work allowance. Every other work allowance is cut or eradicated altogether. The benefits system is very complex now. We've got trouble with our advisors at Citizens Advice. They may come in maybe once a week. And quite frankly, they just can't cope with all the changes. We've got, even within Universal Credit, we've got three different systems running in parallel. We've got the full service, we've got the digital service, which is slightly different, and you've got the gateway conditions. They've all got different eligibilities, plus you've got the legacy benefit system also running in parallel. And our advisors have to understand that, you know, to do benefits checks, basically, what circumstances would trigger a universal credit claim, what circumstances wouldn't trigger a universal credit claim, and if so, would they be better remaining on legacy benefits, etc. There's all sorts of issues. It makes things much more complex. And generally speaking, apart from people that wouldn't have been eligible for working tax credits because of the hours they worked, it doesn't make work pay as much as working the previous system.
Thank you. I think that brings us neatly on to Rob McGowan's.
Yeah, I mean, I think the when sort of universal credit was announced, CAS supported the principle simplifying the benefit system, making work pay, I think a sort of worthy objectives. In practice, I think there's been a lot of difficulties and a lot of challenges, both in the initial limited rollout to single claimants, to with obviously non-complex claims, both in terms of some design issues, some sort of administration and transitional issues. In the full service areas, so sort of Musselburgh, Inverness, Kirkintilloch, and soon to be Inverclyde, there have been a sort of range more with the full service universal credit, so replacing all the six benefits that it replaced. I think certainly for it to live up to its principles, then there are a lot of issues that would need to be addressed, both with the elements of the design of the system, including some of the changes that have made since its announcement, which have undermined the principle of making work pay, and also in terms of how we transition over to the new system and how it's administered.
Kaina, did you wish to come in that particular?
Yes, I think it's maybe not my place to give an organisational view on the principles of universal credit, because in advocacy we're there to give voice to the people that we work with, and they may have very different views. So can't give you a view on the principles, but in practice, kind of agree with what's been said already. If it was meant to simplify the system, I don't think that is working at the moment. It's certainly much more complicated for people that we work with. I don't think we've seen even the full implications of it yet, but even to get a claim off the ground is much harder for people now. They have to gather a lot of complex and diffuse information to get a claim started. So you may have to go to a GP to get a fit note. You may also have to go to open a bank account, which is and open an email address, which you have to provide, as well as getting evidence of your tenancy from a landlord. So there's a lot of different places you have to go to get the information required, even to get a claim off the ground. So I think it's, and that has to be done in a short time frame. So I think for people, it has made the process of applying much more complicated than it used to be under legacy benefits.
Mr. Campbell, you'd mentioned the fact about obviously the advisors and the very complex situation previously and now even more complex. Would you say that possibly need more training, more advisors? There's not enough advisors in that respect. Would that help in any way, or would they still have to go through, I'll pronounce your name properly now, Kina, would they still have to go through the same issues as Kina is saying?
The problem with CAB and a lot of voluntary organisations is that we only have, the advisors only maybe turn up once a week, maybe one afternoon a week, for instance. We do try to train people that you have to understand that they're at different times. They're giving their time anyway, freely. We have had advisors in for training, and so they're given more time to come to the training. The other point is they're dealing with all issues. So unless the training's reinforced, you know, next few times they come in, then they're going to forget it because it's very complex. We do give them handouts and things, but even that, it's very difficult for them to keep the facts in mind because they are very complex and very contradictory within themselves a lot of the time.
Just to pick up on one more point before I go to another member who has a question. Kina, you mentioned that obviously even before you start the claim, you've got to get perhaps a letter from your doctor, you've got to open a bank account, that type of thing. Do you have evidence that doctors charge for these letters? How difficult it is? I know how difficult it is for people to open bank accounts if they're not familiar with it. So what is a rough timescale? I mean, people falling through the gap in that respect?
So, sorry if I wasn't clear, but I meant to get a fit note from a doctor if they're applying for limited capability for work, part of universal credit, so not a letter as such. People do fall through the gap. Some of the most vulnerable people that we've worked with have had to start the claim again because it lapses after 7 days if you haven't had this appointment because of difficulties opening bank accounts. Not everyone has, for example, the photographic ID that you need to open a bank account, so it can be difficult, yes.
Thank you so much. I know that some of the other members wanted to come in. Adam Tompkins, I think you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I mean, just a question about this this issue about confusion of eligibility. There's some evidence, including, I think, from CAS and also Child Poverty Action Group, that there is some confusion about eligibility criteria. I wonder if these are, in your view, design problems with universal credit, or if they're transition problems in terms of the transition from the legacy benefits to universal credit, or both. And I wonder what lessons there might be that we need to learn in terms of the social security devolution that's coming during the course of this parliament, in terms of managing as smoothly as possible eligibility criteria. I'm very concerned by this evidence that matters have become more complex. Matters have become unnecessarily complex. It seems to many of us that it is necessarily going to be the case that the devolution of some of our social security system is going to add complexity rather than diminish it. I wonder if you could reflect on that.
I think certainly in terms of the live service rollout, which is available everywhere in Scotland, there's a long list of people. It runs to, I think, about two pages of different criteria that would exclude people from the have at this point. That's made it very difficult to assess whether someone might be eligible for universal credit or for one of the legacy benefits. An additional problem we found when people are trying to apply is that they'll go onto the website and it'll say universal credit's available in your area. You can't claim job seekers allowance through this, you should claim universal credit. You go into the universal credit website and fall foul of one of the criteria. For instance, if they've got a partner, if they're pregnant, if they've got family serving in the armed forces, or they've got a claim open for something else, so they're challenging a decision, it'll say you're not eligible, you should claim job seekers allowance, and back and forth. And I think at the initial stage is even when people were to phone them up, that would be it would be unclear and would take in some cases several phone calls to verify which of the benefits they're entitled to. The phone number, incidentally, not being a free phone number, can be quite costly. As you heard from Archie and Keena, the process of applying for universal credit will often involve having ID, having an email address, being able to open a claim online, which a substantial proportion of people are unable to do. And that's before reach the stage of a 6-week gap before people receive any payment. So it is, I'm not sure to what extent, or at least at the moment, that it's simplified the system to a great degree.
I just want to come in and ask Alison, do you want to come in on the back of that?
Just very briefly, where did this insistence that applications must be made online come from? I mean, and are you aware of what level that was discussed? Because clearly that is a barrier for a great many people.
It was a policy that the government had, I think, around 2012, 2013, and since then we've been particularly concerned about it. I think the thinking behind it was twofold. One was that thought it would be an administrative saving. I think there was around concept that people would, to get a job, they would need some form of digital skills. So it was helping people in that way. That there's a behind universal credit that in some ways it's supposed to replicate work, the issue that's to be where there are people who will either not be able to access an internet connection at home or a decent connection. There's people who have potentially never used a computer in their lives, there's people who struggle with literacy and numeracy, which can make it difficult to claim online. The process of monthly benefits is also difficult. We sort of surveyed clients on a couple of occasions, and this is the most recent one was that the basic 1 in 5 can't use a computer at all. 1 in 5 have never used the internet. 59% they couldn't make a claim for benefits online without help. 54% couldn't apply for a job online without help. So I think there's still a long way to go before you could move to an online-only system. And I think there's probably also sort of cautionary tales in that for developing a new devolved Scottish system in terms of how people are able to make a claim.
Did you want to come in the back of that? Oh, sorry, Mr. Campbell wanted to come in.
There's a couple of things that Mr. Tompkins made. In the full service areas, it's the criteria for being put onto universal credit basically are a new claim for a means-tested legacy benefit or a change of circumstances that would trigger a new claim for a legacy benefit. So for instance, if you make a new claim for a change of circumstances for housing benefit, and for instance, if you move to a new house within the local authority area, that's a change of circumstances, but it's not a change of circumstances that would trigger a new claim. So you can remain on the legacy benefits. Whereas if you move to another local authority, assuming the local authority is in the full service, that would trigger a new claim. So there's all sorts of confusions about that aspect of it. The other thing you were talking about is transitional payments. Now, that's a big problem. It's a big problem for people who are sick and disabled, who are losing their premiums. What's happening, we're finding, and it's the number one issue, is that people are being called up for a work capability assessment. They're already receiving employment support allowance. They're called up to be reassessed. They're found fit for work, and they must then, if they want money during the mandatory reconsideration period at all, they must then make a claim for universal credit. Otherwise, you know, they can't claim employment and support allowance until their appeal's lodged, which can be like 6 weeks, 2 months. It can be as long as the DWP is deemed as necessary. Now, once they make a claim for universal credit, they remain on universal credit. There's no way back. And once they're on universal credit, if, for instance, they were also getting personal independence payment, if they were getting a daily living award and personal independence payment, they would be entitled to premiums. They would be entitled to severe disability premium if they were the only adult in the house, and if there was nobody claiming carers allowance for them, for instance, which is a substantial amount. It's about £62 a week. They lose that. They can never get it back because there's no legislation in place for transitional payments. The legislation has been put back to 2000. It was put back to 2018. It's my understanding that's been put back again to 2019. And it's only envisaged that it's actually claimants that are moved by the DWP from a legacy benefit onto universal credit that are going to get that transitional protection anyway. So you're going to get thousands upon thousands of claimants claiming disability benefits, sickness benefits, who are going to lose out substantially.
Keena, you wanted to come in on the back of that, and then it's like Ben, you wanted to come in on that question as well. Sorry, Keena.
I just wanted to add something to what Archie was talking about confusions about what change of circumstances would trigger a claim for universal credit. It's certainly true that is a big issue. I think possibly because universal credit was full service was rolled out so quickly to Musselburgh Job Centre, we didn't have that much warning that maybe other people who work in other agencies weren't wholly clear on the circumstances that would trigger a claim in Universal Credit. So I've certainly worked with people who've been advised that moving within the local authority would mean they had to claim UC when in fact they don't. And it's only because we were able to support them to go and get further advice on that that meant that that was clarified. So I think that I think there might be an opportunity to mitigate that somehow in future rollouts, if it were rolled out more slowly or if there were more training for staff that would be involved in advising customers.
Thank you so much. Ben McPherson, you wanted to hear in the back.
Thanks. Yeah, a couple of supplementaries on a few of the points raised there. First of all, Rob Gowans, you spoke a bit about the online service. I just wondered if you or the other panellists wanted to speak in more detail about whether there's any support provided to those who are having difficulty with the online service and your assessment of whether that's adequate or effective, and whether the digital service is causing any distinctive problems like with the ones you've already mentioned. Just slightly to the side of that, but also interrelated, I noted, Archie Campbell, in your written evidence, thanks very much for that, you raised the point about multiple and expensive phone calls. And just wondered if you wanted to comment further on the problems around that, and particularly in relation to the online service. I can imagine that there are certainly from constituents that I've spoken to, there's a frustration about the online service, and then you don't have enough support with that, so you try to make a phone call, and then that's prohibitive and difficult to make communication that way. And also, I thought a really interesting point that was just made by Kenny Rees about rolling out too quickly the system. I wondered if any of the other panellists wanted to make any further comment on that, because that's certainly a criticism that I've heard before.
Well, in terms of the digital support that was provided, I know that it was particularly difficult in East Lothian when it first rolled out. Potentially to sort of Archie to say more on that. What I think is, I think we potentially, even though we knew it was going to be a problem, we actually underestimated how many people would need support, and it's ongoing support as well. If people with no digital skills at all, then they'll need to be taken right through it, from setting up an email to making a claim, and to managing the claim as well, which is going to take ongoing effort. If one of the sort of the initial problems was not so much that there wasn't access to the computers themselves. There's computers in libraries. There's computers in the job centre as well. It's just of getting people who are able to be there to teach them. That sort of it's something that we've nearly raised with the DWP. And that they're trying to put arrangements in place with local authorities as it rolls out, but it's going to be, I would say, a sort of a very substantial challenge in the sort of the amount of work that we would need to put in to make that happen. In terms of the distinctive features of the full service compared with the live service, I think there's probably two things. One is that generally the claimants are from more vulnerable people. The live service was to a very limited amount of people, and I think in terms of both the sort of the volume of inquiries and the complexity of them seems to have increased. One of the other features that's cropped up in addition to the one that's been flagged up around ESA reassessments is to do with people who are in work but are paid weekly. Because Universal Credit's assessed on a monthly basis, you'll sometimes come to months where there's 5 weeks in a month and someone would receive 5 weekly payments. What can happen is that that might push them over the earnings limit and they would not be entitled to any Universal Credit for that month. What was happening under the previous system was happening, but at least people would their Universal Credit would claim would stay open for 6 months. So if their earnings dropped below that, then it would back onto it. What's then to happen now is that the universal credit claim is closed and they have to reapply, which causing potentially cause even more difficulties. And over something that I think that's quite a feature of that I think probably should have been built into the system. From the police official figures that 49% of people in low paid work are paid more frequently than once a month. Our colleagues at Citizens Advice England and Wales looked into did some work with clients and found that 60% of them weren't paid monthly before they start on the universal credit claim. So it's, I think that's probably one of the answers that will be faced to get a good integrated in and out of work system is dealing with the frequency of payments and that everybody isn't paid monthly. In terms of being rolled out too quickly, it's obviously been something that's been in the been in development for a long time. It's announced in 2010, 2011. The first claims were taken in towards the tail end of 2013. So it's been a long rollout already. I think particularly in Lothian, there wasn't a lot of time between the announcement of it and it going live. Understand that the DWP policy is now to give at least sort of 6 months warning, which I think is better, and hopefully it's sort of learning from the experience of Musselburgh, where there was I think there was limited time for everybody, including the local job centre, to get ready for it.
I just wanted to ask if our other two witnesses had anything to add to that, because obviously we've got two lots of witnesses. This first lot, we finish at 10:15 and the next lot to come in, so we've still got a number of questions to get through. Kina and Archie, did you have anything quickly to add to that before we move on to the next question?
The situation is somewhat worse than Rob made out there. It's like for weekly payments, it's not just weekly payments, there's people paid four weekly, but also hardly anybody's paid in the calendar month. They're paid in the last Thursday of the month or whatever. Now, if their assessment period happens to be towards the end of the month, these people will get two paydays twice in a year or something like that, which means the two paydays will be taken into account for that assessment period. They'll get little or no universal credit for that. And then the next, they'll get no payday, so they'll get the full universal credit. Now, that isn't such a problem at the moment, because what, apart from budgeting, apart from the fact that people expect the payment, it's not such a problem, because they're actually a few pennies better off if you take it over a two-month period. However, in April 2014, they're going to introduce another bit of legislation called the excess earnings legislation. So that means anything you are over the threshold will be taken into account in the next assessment period. So that means all these people that Rob has indicated and myself are going to be worse off. That means everybody that's on universal credit. They've just not thought this through at all. I think this is incompetence rather than something that's been done on purpose. The other thing I wanted to make clear, it's they talk about an online system, a digital by default system. Many clients are confused about that. They hear that and quite rightly think it is a digital system. However, it's not. It's a hybrid system. You have to make a phone call within 7 days at the end of the claim, otherwise your claim's closed down. The IT system's so badly designed that we find that people, even people that are IT literate and highly intelligent, don't notice the link to take you on to tell you what the phone number is, or to even tell you that there is a phone call required. So it's a mess.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Did you want to come in, Kino, on a small... Back up that one.
I just wanted to add a few more thoughts about the issues with the digital by default nature of universal credit. Just to make sure everyone knows, we offer independent advocacy to people with mental health issues. And so the people we work with some of them may have issues with memory or concentration or motivation, learning new tasks, things like that. And it's those things that can make using the system particularly difficult. So people are, as I said earlier, expected to have an email address, which is often set up just for the purposes of the claim, and manage a password, which is quite long. I think it's 12 or 16 digits. It's a long password. And the difficulties of that mean that people then are relying on external services to manage that for them and help them to remember what their password is and things. And that obviously isn't particularly secure for people's claim. Other thing to say is that you can ask to have communication be by text rather than email. You have to ask, it's not offered to you. But even then, you're expected to update your journal and make changes online. And again, I think it just makes people more reliant on external services for support with that when they maybe have no experience of sort of systems that you have to use, digital systems. So it's one of the biggest barriers that people face and one of the biggest changes from legacy benefits.
Thank you very much for that. Paula McNeil.
Thank you very much. Good morning. And I'd just like to put on record, as everyone else has, just how valuable your evidence has been. And thank you for the written additions. Firstly, I wanted to ask you about the impact of universal credit payments not being made on time or some of the other issues you've already talked about. What is the impact that you're seeing on claimants of delays?
I think that one of the main issues is debt. And it's going to be a huge issue in going forward. What's happening just now, to be fair, the East Lothian Council were very good about this at the beginning. The sort of their eligibility criteria for crisis grants, they sort of extended that slightly so that people who could get a crisis grant within that six-week period. This was when it was introduced. They're tightening up again and reverting back to the original eligibility criteria, which is if you've got access to, for instance, a benefit advance, you won't get a crisis grant, which was the original way that the legislation was supposed to work. That's purely because they've run out of cash. So they have been very helpful in that regard. That's the problem with these benefits advances is that they can be quite substantial. You're talking about like a six-week period now before people get paid, and that's assuming things go according to plan. So we find that clients are already in debt by the time they get their first payment. And bearing in mind these are subsistence payments, it's not a good situation. All it is like they'll get into more and more and more debt. If you couple with that the problems that clients are finding on a regular basis with getting their housing costs element paid, and probably another witness will be able to tell you more about that, from the council. It's not joined up thinking. It's going to cause a big problem for social services across the board. The thing I think that people that make these decisions in the first place forget is that benefits are a very efficient way of distributing money. For poverty reasons, a very efficient way. All these cuts that are being made to benefits, in the end, you're gonna end up spending more money across the board, patching up the problems that it causes. I feel, and I think there's evidence to suggest that. As I say, I don't think they've thought this through at all. I think this is politically driven, and I think it's not. I mean, what Rob was saying as well about maybe lessons will be learned. I'm even sceptical about that, because the system was in, implemented, full service was implemented down in Croydon, down in Sutton, long before it was implemented in Musselburgh, and we're seeing the same problems that they had being exported up here. They had a long time to sort these problems out, and nothing was done.
So presumably, so people who are in debt because they waiting on their benefits arriving in that 6-week period, so they'll have interest on top of that to pay back. So the maths are never really,
no.
Or you're talking about, or?
I'm talking about benefit advances.
Benefit advances, thank you. You've already touched on some of this already about claimants struggling to manage universal credit, but I wanted you just to address that specifically. And, I mean, just as a point of information, we put this point to Damien Green, the minister who came to the committee last week, that when the Parliament gets its new powers, there's a desire to move to fortnightly payments. And in fact, I made this point myself that that it would be helpful to be able to do that because I know that people can manage their money better. And the figures that you've given us is quite helpful. But I don't think that's widely understood, that still nearly 50% of people in work get paid more regularly than once a month. Anyway, that's just a point of information. But yeah, it would be helpful if you could just outline to the committee how claimants might struggle with universal credits.
Maybe Kina could maybe tell you a bit about vulnerable clients, because we've had there's a certain crossover between the work we do and the work with CAPS. We have a lot of clients from CAPS, and we're finding, like, for instance, a lot of clients maybe just have post office accounts. They don't like people with post office accounts. They don't dislike people with post office. They just don't like post office accounts because they can't impose direct debits, etc., on post office accounts, apparently. So that, I think that's the reasoning behind that. So clients are, you can certainly start a claim with a post office account, but very quickly they're advised they must set up a bank account, a proper bank account. Now, this is very easy for clients, or relatively easy for clients who aren't vulnerable. But for a lot of clients that we see, a lot of clients, I'm sure that Kina will tell you about them, they really struggle. Their life is fairly chaotic, and they've lost all their ID. First of all, we have to get them ID, which starts with going to register house, getting a birth certificate, and then for vulnerable clients, it just isn't working at all. I mean, I'm sure that there's going to be winners in the universal credit lottery. There's going to be people, for instance, that are IT literate. They're on 0 hours contracts, and it's going to be fantastic for them. It's going to be because like in the past, basically they had nothing apart from working tax credits, which was very, very risky if you were on a 0 hours contract, because you were meant to sort of like try and average out what your earnings were over any period, and you were prone like to get massive overpayments, etc. You might still get overpayments in this situation, but they're going to be manageable. So for that small group, it's going to make a positive difference. For every other group, though, I can just see it as a way of getting into debt. Even there's so many ways you can get into debt through universal credit. The like overpayments, any changes of circumstances, which they take into account for the whole assessment period. If you don't remember to inform them within that assessment period, they'll claw the money back the problem versus legacy benefits is the clawback of the money that you owe to the DWP through overpayments is clawed back at a much higher rate.
Sorry, can I ask, obviously we have another panel,
sure.
And I'm going to have I'm going to make this one run on another 10 minutes and I'll add a 10 minutes to the next panel and cut where we have read the written submission that was sent in, and it's been very good, as the member said. I just wonder, is there anything else that maybe Keena or Rob wanted to say? Have you finished?
Thank you.
In regards to that, or can we move on? I know there's two members that wanted to come in on that particular question. I'll bring the two members in, and then perhaps Rob and Keena can perhaps... Did you want to come back into that question, George, in that particular issue?
Well, no.
Oh, right, I thought it was. I know that Gordon wanted to come in on that particular issue.
Yes, thanks. Just listening to Archie Campbell's comments, what I'm interested in is what are your proposed solutions to the situation, in particular with regard to the six-week period, for example, when a claim is lodged? How could the system be altered to address the problems that you have commented on? For example, if someone doesn't have a bank account, if that has to be set up, questions of ID, administrative difficulties, what is it that you would propose to specifically address these difficulties? And perhaps the other panel members may have suggestions themselves.
Yeah, I suppose to kind of touch on the point that Pauline McNeill made and Gordon Lindhurst's question at the same time. In terms of the monthly payments, as she outlined, these are very difficult for people to manage. We've done a bit of work with trying to understand how clients budget at the moment. It works out reasonably split between people who budget weekly, budget fortnightly, budget monthly. What we've suggested is that as part of the flexibilities that have been devolved, in addition to giving people a choice of fortnightly and monthly payments, they could be given a choice of weekly payments. When they prefer to receive their benefits, 55% would prefer weekly, only about 13% would prefer monthly, and the remainder would prefer fortnightly. So we think it's an option that should be offered. In terms of trying to address the six-week gap at the start, I think there's a couple of things you could do. Firstly, remove the 7 waiting days at the start of a claim. So this is basically when somebody's applied, the first 7 days of their claim, they'll receive no payment for at any point. What we'd also suggest is that there's people... would get a single payment potentially halfway through the waiting period that was not repayable. As you mentioned, the advance payments that you have at the moment would need to be repaid out of sort of future universal credit payments. So would be receiving reduced payments for a while. I think that if a payment was made during the period, it will help to tide people over and give them some money up front when it's needed, rather than 6 weeks later when they've been through it, when they may have accumulated quite a lot of debt.
I'm just wondering how that addresses the initial problems if they don't have a bank account, they don't have ID, there's administrative things to be gone through. I appreciate that will address things ongoing, but what about that initial period?
I think in terms of it's making so things like post office card accounts, simple payments where needs be. Some of the things you can get universal credit made into a post office card account, but I'm not sure whether it's changed recently. But it used to be quite difficult to do so. I think probably the is that it's obviously not be a good thing if everybody had bank accounts, but reality is that we're not there yet. So I think that's making it as easy as possible for it to be paid in ways that suit people when they require it.
Keena, did you want to come in on that particular one before we move on to the next question?
Yeah, so I think the experience people that certainly we've worked with have had has been that you can't progress with the claim until you've provided kind of all the information. And if you don't provide it, then the claim can lapse and you have to start again. So I think if there was more time or a way to carry on with the rest of the claim, even if some information was incomplete, and provide that later. Things like getting a bank account, it can take time if you haven't got the ID that you need, but you would then have no access to benefits in that time while you're doing that. So if there was some way around that, it might take the pressure off people's experience of having to do it all very quickly.
Thank you very much. Ruth Maguire.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being here. We heard evidence from DWP about the delay of 6 weeks being to replicate work, and you've laid out in your written evidence and some of the things you've told us this morning, some of the issues that causes. Can I just ask a quite specific question about the ease that your clients have in accessing advance payments, which are meant to be there to cushion that weight a bit, and also any thoughts you have on what more could be done to support claimants waiting for their first payment?
Well, I don't know. I think the idea that the council had given out crisis loans was a good one. Unfortunately, the pot of money is finite, and so that was only able to be instigated up to a point. So now, for instance, they're falling back onto the original eligibility criteria, which is basically if you've got access to any money, then you have to use that. But certainly the suggestion that Rob made would be welcome. If for instance, within that six-week period, if they insist on the six-week period in the first place, which is not a good idea, then they should have access to grants rather than loans, things that are non-repayable. The DWP might well think it's replicating the world of work. It's not replicating the world of work. This is subsistence money. It's basically anybody that falls below that subsistence is in real trouble. So it doesn't resemble the world of work at all. I know that there's people on very low wages, et cetera, et cetera, but I would suggest that, you know, in the past there have been some safety nets. I think the safety nets are being taken away. Things like housing benefit, for instance.
You finished, Mr. Campbell?
Yes, sure.
Sorry. Rob Gowan, did you want to come in on that particular point, or Keena?
Yeah, I mean, I think it is difficult across the country. I've seen people who build to pay for utility bills, or need to rent arrears, council tax arrears, to borrow from friends and family, and to go to food banks, and to the Scottish Welfare Fund, or in some cases Section 12 or 22 social work payments. The Scottish Welfare Fund is very helpful where it exists, but as has been mentioned, it's only a limited pot of money, and I think it's the 6 week wait for a universal credit payment is going to place massive pressure on the Scottish Welfare Fund budget across the country.
Keena, did you want to come in on that one before Ruth perhaps wants to come back in it?
Just to say that as well, and people's experience has been that benefit advances that are available is not sort of proactively offered. You have to sort of ring up and ask for it. So that can be a barrier as well.
Did you want to come back to another one?
Just moving on, slightly, convener, to alternative payment arrangements. Just to ask your reflections on how that's currently working. And thinking about moving forward when those responsibilities come to us, what lessons we can learn from that. We've taken evidence previously about the difficulty that a single household payment can cause, particularly to families that are vulnerable to violence, if there's domestic abuse in the home. There are obviously other issues as well. So just to hear your reflections on that.
So the point you made about the domestic abuse is a good one, because there's all sorts of issues around that, because basically now if people have partners, they have to claim together. They can't complete the claim without the partner. And as you say, if the partner's abusive, that creates real problems. There are some safeguards in place. They're not nearly good enough. There was another thing. What was the second part of the question again?
I've actually forgotten. Yeah. That was quite a long question, wasn't it? So, no, it was just to hear how you feel it's working now, because obviously there are flexibilities available now, and just what lessons we can learn as that responsibility comes to us, how we can try and do a bit better.
Yeah, just basically reverting back to what, like Rob said, the payment arrangements on legacy benefits, if they could do it then, and they can surely do it now, like things like simple payments, things like, you know, more regular payment periods, etc. I'm sure it's not beyond them to be able to do that, even if they have to do that out with the digital system.
And can I just briefly, convener, are your clients aware that those flexibilities exist in the system? How easy is it for them to request them?
Not very flexible at the moment. We've tried, for instance, for getting vulnerable claimants to get their housing cost element paid directly to the landlord. They're not keen to do that at all, we find. And it's at the moment, it's difficult. Hopefully, with the powers that you're getting to tweak the universal credit a bit, then that'll change. Because that's a major one, I think.
Thank you. George, did you want to come in on that particular issue there? Oh, another issue. Right, OK, George, you want to come in on that?
Thank you, convener, and good morning. I would just like to ask about individuals' journeys through the process, in particular people with ill health and disabilities, because in Musselburgh CAB's submission, you've got a section in that you talk about the fact that clients that have a live Medical 3 stating that the claimant is not fit for work, they go through the system and they end up automatically being assigned to actually being fit for work and made to look for employment. So how is this happening? You know, because we've basically got a work coach that's making that decision, and how are they medically qualified to make that decision? You know, what is the point there?
Very big problem. The situation in the past, was this: if somebody made a claim for employment and support allowance, then they went through an assessment period, at which time it was taken as given that they were sick, and so their benefit was paid an assessment rate, which was basically the same rate as job seekers allowance until they were assessed. However, that doesn't happen now. What happens is the claimant will make a claim for universal credit. They'll take up a live Med 3. Then they'll be put on the full conditionality group to begin with. Now, within that, the work coach has got lots of discretion to say what their claimant commitment should be. The problem there is that a lot of medical conditions people could come across as quite normal, or for instance, maybe somebody's having a good day in that particular day when they're being assessed in quotation marks by the work coach. It's completely wrong. I don't think, unfortunately, what we're talking about here is a reserve benefit. So I realise that the Scottish Government's quite limited in what it can do. But one of the things we'd like to see is the reintroduction of an assessment period for people that present a Med 3. It's just not right that the work coaches, it's not right that for the work coach themselves, it must be very stressful for them to try and make a decision, and then maybe somewhere down the line something goes wrong that they didn't envisage. That's a big problem. It's the assessment period now is they're talking about it should be for a month and then they should be assessed. I think that's their intention. I think, like ESA, which used to be 13 weeks, I think that's going to be pushed further and further back as they get busier.
OK, Campbell. I've already extended it for 10 minutes and I'm going to do it for another five, so that's 15 minutes, and obviously it gives us less time for the rest. I just wanted to bring Keena in, is that? And then Rob, if you've want to come in, and then George, if you wanted to come back in that. And then Mark.
So,
could possibly be, thank you.
Just wanted to add a little bit about the climate commitment. And when we've supported people at the climate commitment interviews, which is to agree on what the commitment will be on the job search, the starting point is often high. It's often the full kind of job search. And you then have to sort of negotiate down to what is manageable for the person we're supporting. And that's something that's often quite difficult for people to do, to ask for that to be lower, because you're applying for benefit and you feel maybe pressure to agree to what's required. So it's difficult for people.
Okay. Rob, did you want to come in quickly?
Yeah, just obviously that's going to be a massive challenge as Universal Credit rolls out. Previously, there were two different benefits, Job Seekers Allowance and Employment Support Allowance. It's alluded to it, placed a lot of pressure on the work coach to be able to, on what would actually be appropriate and suitable. And the concern I have is that if somebody doesn't mention something and gets inappropriate conditions, or it was as Keena said, that they should try and do things, and is that that can lead to people being sanctioned and concerned that sort of some very vulnerable people can face sanctions.
I actually think sanctions one is a huge one. So, do you want to come? Because I want to bring in Mark. So we do have another session anyway with other witnesses. Okay. Do you want to follow up on that one?
Just quickly, when Archie brought up the idea of ESA, you've mentioned earlier on, basically, if you go through the process and you end up in Universal Credits, there ain't no going back, that's quite a terrifying kind of idea for someone who may have a long-term condition, as you say. On that day, they had a good day. Is this not just a case that anything that we do or the Scottish Government does is just tinkering about with the universal credit system, which is the whole system is a flawed system at the moment?
The whole system is a flawed system, but there is something. The thing is, they are assessed, and it's similar to employment and support allowance in the long run. Once they are assessed and found unfit for work, it's similar, but minus the premiums.
Could we move on to the next question, basically? I think you're all in agreement with that. Would that be correct, Jeff? Mark Griffin, please.
I wanted to talk about universal credit and earnings, and I know we're pushed for time. We've already covered issues around people who are paid weekly or fortnightly or four-weekly. So I just wondered if you had any comments on those who have declared themselves self-employed, how they manage their month-to-month earnings and balancing that with what they claim for through universal credit. And also the issue where the DWP define anyone who's self-employed as earning the national minimum wage for their declared hours. I mean, people, as we know, people who are self-employed could earn far less than the national minimum wage for working those hours. And just any experience of any difficulties of people who have come to you who have declared themselves self-employed.
That's not been a huge issue up till now. I think it's going to be more of an issue further down the line as people come off working tax credits, as self-employed people come off working tax credits. I think it'll be a huge issue because if they've been on working tax credits, of course, for more than a year, if they've been self-employed for more than a year, they're automatically right away subject to the minimum income floor, which is what you're alluding to, where they're deemed to be making the national minimum wage. As I say, we've not seen a lot. There are exemptions for certain people. We've seen a couple of people that would have been subject to the minimum income floor, but they were, for instance, they had limited capability for work, for example. So there's exemptions for them. So we've not seen a lot of it. It's probably not seen enough people to comment on it in any meaningful way up till now. Yeah.
Keena or Rob, do you want to come in quickly on that particular one?
Yeah, I think that's the kind of the particular difficulty that encountered. And I don't think it's happened to a great extent yet, but for instance, if someone was self-employed, had incurred expenses, but wasn't to receive payment until the next month, because of the way the system works, they won't be fully compensated within Universal Credit. In terms of people who are on, I suppose, sort of contractual situations such as we've seen sort of recently with the case of the Uber drivers, where they may be self-employed or not, that can, in theory, sort of Universal Credit works well for fluctuating hours. It certainly doesn't mean they're, like we've seen before with zero-hours contract workers, that they jump between, they're not able to either claim job seekers' allowance or working tax credits. One of the things that I think all of this will rely on is it working well with the HMRC real-time information system, so that they're getting full information about people being paid. And I think there's an awful lot of expectation on people to make all the changes within the system and declare all the changes in.
I'll need to draw to a close at this moment. We've extended for 15 minutes, but hopefully I can extend that to the next panel as well. Thank you all very, very much. I just, suspend the meeting, well, not even suspend the meeting, just to change over of witnesses for 1 or 2 minutes. And can I thank you all very, very much? We could have went on all day, I must admit. It was excellent. Thank you. Thank you very much, and thank you for your patience, and hopefully add the extra 15 minutes onto your time as well. It's a very interesting subject, and everyone obviously is desperate to get their questions and answers in there as well. So thank you very, very, very much for coming along. And our second panel of witnesses today are Sheila McCandy, Benefits and Welfare Manager of Highland Council, and Rena Hunter, Service Manager, Health and Social Care Partnership, Inverclyde Council, and John Cunningham, Service Manager, Benefits and Financial Assessments, East Lothian Council. So to be fair to not just the witnesses, but to obviously the members, I know that Gordon Lindhurst didn't get an opportunity, at the first. So Gordon, if you want to lead off with the questions.
Thank you very much, Convener. What I'm interested in is the question of conditionality and sanctions. Now, some have suggested that there shouldn't be sanctions in relation to Universal Credit or other benefits. What I'm interested in asking you about is, first of all, can you envisage a system that had no sanctions at all built into the system as a sort of end stop, as it were, a final resort? And second, what would such a system look like? Can you give some pointers on how that would operate and what the framework would be, assuming you think that such a system could be designed?
Who wishes to take the first one? Mr. Cunningham?
I suppose we relate sanctions with the employability aspect of what's been achieved here as well, because if you bring in a system like Universal Credit, you have to have some way of making sure that people adhere to the rules. And in that respect, and coming from a housing benefit background, you know, we're all about making sure that people are only claiming what they're due and sticking to the principles involved, I guess. So I guess I'm not entirely against a sanctions regime per se. I think it's how it's actually deployed and whether it's being administered in a mature way, I guess, is what I would, the point I would make.
I think, Paul, what I would add to that is I think the point around sanctions and conditionality is that a number of clients and claimants don't actually understand them. They don't understand that they have been, that there's conditions attached to their various benefits. And actually, I think that's the point that we really need to strengthen, is that they need to have a much better understanding of actually what they're signing up to as part of their claimant commitment. And, you know, the understanding that if they don't happen to be able to meet the claimant commitment, then there's obviously repercussions for that. I think we need to be really, really clear that clients are aware of exactly what they're signing up to. And I think that's a key point, that they're not always completely aware of what that is. And I think that's the point that we need to focus on.
Okay. Also, I was just going to get the other witness who wanted to come in.
Just wanting to come in on what has just been said. Do you have any ideas about how that can be better put across to claimants?
Yeah. I think one of the conversations that we've tried to have locally within Inverclyde is, particularly for those clients that have mental health issues, we have had some thoughts that actually the claimant, the claimant agreement should actually perhaps be a three-way agreement. So it should be discussed and designed between the client, between the work coach, and with, for example, their caseworker, if they're a mental health client. That means that that client is then signing up to a commitment that they're able to do, that their caseworker, key worker, is able to actually help them understand that, and also give agreement that actually that would be a useful agreement for that client, rather than the client you know, agreeing to a commitment that actually, with their particular condition, they've got absolutely no way of maintaining.
Scandal.
Thank you. The committee may be aware that DWP do not publish sanctions for universal credit. Certainly in Highland, we haven't had a very bad experience of sanctions. Between April 15 and March 16 in Highland, there was 136 sanctions levied for job seekers allowance. One of the things we've done in Highland is we've made sure that housing support providers are encouraged to attend the job centre with their clients when they're signing up to their claimant commitment. And that means there's more viable claimant commitments that are being signed up to. We also ensure that our welfare support officers are present in the job centre at least one day a week. And that's also been very helpful in achieving more viable and more achievable commitments. And hopefully that means that there will be fewer sanctions. I would, however, agree that you do need some sort of mechanism to ensure that people understand what their commitment is to receive money from the state and how that would help them move into employment.
Thank you very much. Did you want to come back in?
No, that's fine.
Ben McPherson, you want to come back in this particular one?
It was to ask a separate question, can be that? Is that okay? Thanks all. I just, from you mentioned the housing perspective, I just wondered if you could comment on whether there has been a change in the level of rent arrears as a result of universal credit since it was initiated.
Substantially.
Perhaps you could comment further on that, perhaps numbers or specific reasoning and repercussions.
Rent arrears in East Lothian, whilst it had started at a high point even prior to the live service, there had been major inroads made last year, even through the period that the live service was operating. But again, the live service was small volumes, you know, and you could say that it wasn't really the step change, I think, didn't really happen until the full service came in. And I think it's been apparent from the first session as well. What we are seeing is now, since the full service is in operation, I think it's in East Lothian, it's 82% of council tenants who are in receipt of universal credit are involved in some level of arrears. And it's also, I don't have the figures in front of me, but there's a higher average arrear by the higher average arrear is higher by about £300 over the typical arrear in East Lothian as well, which I think is something like £857, I think it is.
I'll come in from an Inverclyde perspective. We don't have any of our own housing stock, so we work closely with our local RSLs. Just some information from one of our RSLs, of 70 claims for UC, and remind committee that we have not gone to full service yet. That happens in 2 weeks' time in Inverclyde. We have 69% of those claimants are in arrears with an approximate arrears of £700 per claimant.
Mr. Camden.
Highland is, so we've got live service and we've got full service. We've got full service in Inverness and live service elsewhere. So mainstream tenancies, the average rent arrear is £627, which is the equivalent of about 8 weeks rent arrears, and that's 367 tenants. For temporary accommodation under live service, there are 12 tenants and 100% of those are in arrears. Full service, the picture worsens. The mainstream tenancies, the average rent arrear is £962, which is the equivalent of 12 weeks rent. And for temporary accommodation, again, 100% of tenants are in arrears who are in receipt of universal credit, and the average rent arrear is £1,108. So significant changes between live and full service.
Did you want to go back in on that one again?
Significant set of figures from across the geographical areas, and I appreciate the different levels of service in different areas, but perhaps you could comment from your anecdotal experience, are there aspects of universal credit that in your view have been consequential and have been the main reasoning behind the changes that you've seen?
I would say under universal credit, the housing element is the greatest challenge for DWP. I think understanding how housing works, how important the payment to the landlord is, and on time, I think that's a huge challenge for them to understand and to actually overcome. APAs have been helpful, alternative payment arrangements have been helpful. We're actually a trusted partner under universal credit, which means when we apply for an APA, it's acted on upon good faith and it's paid automatically to us. The problem with APAs is when the landlord applies for APA, they don't know whether or not it's going to be successful. And there could be very many reasons why it's not successful. So you've got a landlord waiting for their rent and not knowing whether or not that rent is going to come. Tenants also, certainly in council housing, have not been used to paying rent. So they may have been in that tenancy for 20 years and have never had to pay rent because it's always been paid automatically for them. And they're finding it really, really difficult to almost ring fence that rent element from their universal credit payment to ensure it's there to pay their landlord. And there's going to be a huge learning curve there for claimants in receipt of housing element under universal credit.
One more, because a couple other people want to come in the back.
Just on that, do you believe that a resumption of direct payment to landlords would make a meaningful and significant difference?
I think we've got the evidence. Under housing benefit, that happens, and we don't have the same issues. If you think back to local housing allowance, which was introduced in 2008 in the social sector, sorry, in private sector, it's the same principle. The payment goes directly to the claimant, but we don't have the same issues that are presenting under universal credit, because we've got a very robust, all local authorities have got a very robust safeguard process in place whereby the landlord can apply very early on if there's a history of rent arrears, or if the tenant is vulnerable, they can apply for a direct payment. So I think the direct payment will be very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Could I just add to that again? There's one wee difference between Highland and East Lothian at this point in time is Sheila mentioned trusted partnership, which is a status that through the Live Service was offered to a few authorities. It's something that we're looking into just now because we've laterally potentially a possibility to become trusted partner. But it's trying to understand, now that we've had experience in the full service, I think our general view within the council is that APAs aren't necessarily the panacea either. At this point in time, the APA process isn't very efficient. So it's a case, if you were going to accelerate the number of APAs you can actually apply for through a more easier route, it's a case of, well, are you not going to improve the process to make sure that that is delivering the goods at the end as well? So that's been our response. And we did have an opportunity to say to Neil Cooling, the Director General of Universal Credit, he visited us in Musselburgh, and my Chief Executive and myself were able to say, and he was quite surprised and taken aback when I had the response about direct payments not being a panacea, but making sure that under the current arrangements, it's often a recovery rate of something like 20% that they take that money back off of people. And we would say, well, that's no substitute from an early intervention by the council and a more lenient arrangement that leaves more money going into the household. So it's that kind of cultural thing that councils would want to be doing the right thing in a holistic fashion to make sure that we're getting a proper arrangement put in place rather than something that was going to cause potentially more hardship or more debt further down the road.
Did you want to come in, Ms. Hunter, before somebody else?
Because one of the things that we're trying to bring in is a mandatory meeting to discuss budgeting where an APA has been put in place. And obviously, as part of live service and in full service, we do have the personal budgeting support. The uptake of that, as I'm sure you will be aware, through live service has been very poor. But in terms of APAs, we're trying to make sure that a mandatory meeting is put in place.
Okay. George Adams, did you want to come in the back of that? Okay, George.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'd like to continue on the repercussions, not just from, you've already discussed the housing point of view, but is it not the case, Archie Campbell from Musselburgh CAB actually brought up the idea that the system itself, Universal Credit itself, is creating problems elsewhere. You know, when there's a 6-week wait, they have to go to another agency to try and find a way to get themselves through that 6-week period. So is it not the case that they're presenting themselves to places like yourself, you know, to try and say right away they've got problems with their rent, they've got other financial problems, so they go to the council? You know, is it not the case that Archie's right in what he said, that, you know, basically we're shifting problems from the fact that they can't get their money and they're presenting themselves to agencies like yourself?
I'd say it's probably self-evident. Archie quoted you know, the fact that the East Lothian Council was making full use of its Scottish welfare budget. Full use won't last to the 31st of March at this rate. So, you know, we are holding... you're just trying to make the resources stretch to cover as many people as you can make it. It's an inevitable consequence, I would feel, of the waiting period. And whatever the reason for the additional... processing time, and whether it's to match the world of work or just capacity within the service centres to actually match what had previously been maybe a better performance by local authorities on housing benefit performance, averaging 23 days in Scotland or thereabouts. It just strikes me that, you know, these are the key things that would make a difference. But you're right in your assessment that in the absence of that, they are going to come to anywhere that they can get help, and local authorities, amongst other places and food banks and what have you, are the alternatives, I guess.
And I think already we're able to see the difference in terms of how Scottish Welfare Fund has been used in terms of the crisis grants. We can see a difference in the amount that has been awarded from those clients that are on UC to those that are not on UC, and obviously bearing in mind at the moment that's only, you know, for a certain percentage. Universal Credit within Inverclyde is obviously for, you know, single people, etc. And obviously once we start moving into families, we expect the level of the award of crisis grants to rapidly increase.
In Highland, there's been 3,000 claims made so far through Universal Credit, and half of those are still on Universal Credit in terms of the information that we can access, and a third of those are in some form of employment. And through that period in the last year, we've helped 830 people with online support and personal budgeting support. So that's the level of support just in terms of handholding to get through the universal claim process, never mind all the other support services that are being accessed through the local authority.
Thank you. Adam Tompkins, do you want to come in on the back of that particular one? No, you didn't. Alison Johnson, you wanted to come in on that one?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'd just like to focus more on this move from live to full service, and probably to Mr Cunningham in the first instance. In the East Lothian Council submission, it's noted that previously agreed data sharing protocols no longer apply under UC full service, curtailing council officers' ability to make telephone inquiries about universal claimants' entitlement. It's also been pointed out to me that implicit consent, whereby welfare support officers can act on behalf of tenants who've asked them, no longer can if the claimant themselves isn't there. So that's clearly going to severely curtail the number of people who can be helped and just make the process quite unwieldy. So I'm just wondering why, you know, some of the lessons that were learned with the live service haven't been transferred across.
This is a recent development, so it's hot off the press, as it were, in the paper. But the thing is that we've long had a relationship with the DWP through our days of administering housing benefit, where we do have that access to benefit processing centres to be able to support the claimant in that way. And it's been enshrined in a memorandum of understanding that we've held, which covers at least five different disciplines that we look after, and the ability to search, you know, seek that information. They have made this decision, and I can only assume that it's been taken from a security perspective, in that the sensitivities around security within Universal Credit have been quite keen. The original false start of Universal Credit or restart of Universal Credit, I believe, probably associated with the security of the scheme itself, you know. So I think they're very wary of how they go about that. And there's certain things that we've asked for that, for example, hypertext links into local authority application forms and stuff like that from within the Universal Credit application. And we it's a kind of firm no based on a security argument. And I can only assume that this is... It's the specific consent aspect that I know in the future under data commissioners changes that are coming down the road, I think specific consent is going to be something that's going to be a part of that. We'll need to see how that actually develops, but it may be that they're attempting to future proof themselves, but whatever, it's hard to say. But for whatever reason, we're going hot foot from this meeting to another one where we'll be speaking to members of the Universal Credit project team and explaining why, as partners in delivering Universal Credit, it feels a wee bit more difficult to be that type of operating that partnership when you've got things curtailing you in that fashion.
Yeah. I think, you know, just in terms of thinking through some of the implications of that, as you've started to allude to, it makes it very, very difficult for... welfare rights advice workers to act on behalf of their clients. Within Inverclyde, an example has been over the last 12 months, we have a triage advice line. We've taken nearly 12,000 calls to that line for a variety of benefits over the last 12 months. Only 3,000 of them have resulted in face-to-face appointments, because we've managed to act, to triage the call, to give advice, to act on the client's behalf over the phone. Some of that will be in resolving directly with DWP. If that facility is no longer available, the impact then on having to have face-to-face appointments and also having to phone, be in contact with DWP when you have the client in the room with you, when we are starting to experience 3-hour callbacks from DWP, it makes it very difficult to administer an advice service.
Ms McKean, did you want to comment on that as well?
Okay, yes, there's three strands for us. The direct number for landlords has been removed, so landlords can no longer phone the service, under full service, the landlords can no longer phone the service centre. For our own staff within revenues, administering council tax reduction, they can no longer phone the service centre. So we can't get information, we have to go back to the claimant, so that's going to delay payment of council tax reduction. And then for the claimant themselves, which is the most important individual here, particularly the geography that we have in Highland, at the moment it's very convenient for a client to phone us under our welfare support team, for us then to act and on their behalf with the service centre. We will not be able to do that in the future. Now, what that means is we will either have to do a home visit or they will have to travel to us. And the travel distances in Highland, as you all are aware, are extreme. That is building delay into that claimant's universal credit claim, and that could impinge upon them quite detrimentally. So that there's quite large ramifications from this. And as John has said, John and I are just going to a meeting after this meeting to meet with Universal Credit officials, and we will be raising this in very strong terms.
I'm glad to hear that, actually, at your meeting. Alison, do you want to go back in? We've got a number of them.
Yeah, no, I mean, just very briefly, it just seems to me that without implicit consent, I'm not entirely sure who we're making the service work for, because it certainly doesn't seem that the person at the heart of it is going to be assisted in any way. I'm just very surprised that this has been suggested at all.
It'll be a key aspect for any of the devolved powers, you know, for the Scottish Government.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's probably
probably worth also adding, there was no discussion with local authorities regarding this. It did come out of the blue, it really did, and just a week and a half ago was when we found out about it.
Just very quickly, so this is an area in which the Scottish Parliament could decide it wanted to do something entirely different.
You'd still have to have the DWP's agreement on that, I would guess, and that's what you'd be up against then. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. A number of members want to come in, but certainly we had DWP officials at a meeting the other week there, and we were asking about how they're working together with the Scottish Government officials and DWP. We didn't really get a proper answer, so we're following that up because we need to make sure they do work together so there's nobody falls through the net in that respect. Ruth Maguire, you want to come in the back of some of the questions there?
Yes, convener, on the back of some of that. I'm actually a bit astounded by what I've just heard, and I think perhaps it's something that this committee might want to do further probing on. And I think hearing all the effort, both in terms of resource and finance, that's going into kind of just keep people afloat in terms of the Scottish Welfare Fund and the resources that local authorities are putting in. Obviously, we are very grateful that those are going in, but I'm just quite conscious that that's all action and money to just stand still, to just keep people afloat, and what we could do with it if we didn't have to do that. My actual question was actually on the back of what John Cunningham said about the alternative payment arrangements. I just wondered if we could tease that out a bit more. I was just kind of interested in to hear more of your views about, when you say it's not a panacea, it's something that we've sort of been looking hopefully at as something that could impact positively on our constituents if when we had control, if there were different ways we could do things. Just tease out a bit more about your views on that.
I think my own views is are that the APAs are a tool and a key tool. The processes around them have to be improved and will be improved, no doubt. It's very much, we should remember, the whole project, Universal Credit, is on a test and learn basis, and the whole agile design approach that's been made to it is I'm quite sure that some of us as early authorities might be benefiting some other ones down the road when the process is maybe a wee bit more refined. But I think it's just being pragmatic about our watchword with rent arrears has always been to find the early intervention. There's no substitute for that. And that's caused us to commit a lot more resource to rent arrears management. And it has worked. But it's now facing a pressure that's pushing against that. And whilst APAs will remain one of the key tools in the bag, I think we have to have more tools in that bag to make sure that we can support folk as early as possible with arrangements that are manageable that don't cause other problems either.
Did any other witnesses want to answer that particular? I know you did touch on that in previous answers. Anybody else want to comment on that before we move on?
Emphasising the point about automating the APA process. So at the moment, it's very administratively cumbersome for local authorities. And I think that's what John's alluding to. If that process was automated in some way, APAs would be very, very helpful. About 25% of our UC cases are currently, there's an APA in place in Highland.
Gordon Lintas, did you want to come in that particular point?
I wanted to come back in on just a point very briefly from previous point about the rent arrears. And if those in receipt of benefits are used to rental being paid directly rather than them having to handle the money, the purpose of changing the system, as I understand, is so that people have the opportunity to understand their own finances and come to understand how it all fits together, to encourage them to take responsibility for things. But I'm just wondering, from a practical point of view, obviously that has presented problems at the outset. If one is introducing a system like that, would it make more sense to introduce a system like that for people who are new to the benefit system, so in fact are not used to it being done a different way, whereas trying to explain to or change people's thinking who are used to it being done a different way is more difficult perhaps than bringing completely new people into the system, which would be a more gradual changeover? What are your thoughts on that?
Paul. The other thing to bear in mind is that the universal credit payment is not aligned with the weekly rent liability. So certainly for social tenants, their rents are due, in council housing, the rents are due on a weekly basis, but getting paid 4 weekly, they're getting paid monthly. So aligning it to the rent period frequency would also be helpful.
And else want to comment on that, Mr Cunningham? Or
I was just thinking, in a sense, the live service possibly featured more new claimants. Is that a fair thing? So in many ways, the live service maybe gave a run-in on that to an extent, but probably what that didn't tease out is the problems that might have been later faced in the full service, where it's all types of households, many of who have culturally relied on direct payments through housing benefits for a number of years. And no doubt, I think that'll be a feature of what we're contending with now, is like undoing maybe a 30-year culture or longer, you know, of housing benefit direct payment, rent rebates, essentially. You know?
Just to add to that, again, I think what you're alluding to is trying to make sure that we've got more preventative and kind of early intervention methods in, and obviously in terms of, you know, we really do want to try and improve our community's financial capability. I think that's a key area that we need to work through other areas, through schools, through education, etc. Just around trying to expand and, you know, help people understand the need for them to be able to budget and just have a much kind of more rounded approach to, you know, managing their finances.
I want to come back in on that one.
Just to come on the back of that, is just an initiative that is taking place in East Lothian. Is East Lothian, and not probably launched before we understood that full service was coming into the county, but the East Lothian Poverty Commission is a piece of work that's just due to report out about now. And it's the key things there is just what Andrina has shared, is there's many things about understanding the causes of poverty within the county, understand what it looks like, and we see a lot of these things like education through schools, and in particular community resilience has been a key thing, because I think what we're finding is, whether you're a CAB or a local council office or whatever, is like there's a number of areas that people naturally turn to, and I guess it's like by strengthening communities, it's like an expanding the areas that people can get good quality advice from, because I think that's something that is going to be needed. You know?
Absolutely. I know, Alison, you wanted to come back in on that.
Yeah, just on the direct payments point, I mean, obviously we want to empower those who can to take control of their own budgets and decide what should happen and when. But I just... Is it your view that there are adequate safeguards in place for those who are more vulnerable, who need help with budgeting? And because obviously if housing associations and so on don't get paid, that has an impact on housing availability for all. So
obviously through Universal Credit, there is a personal budgeting support built in as part of the delivery agreement. The uptake of that within Inverclyde, and I think it's been replicated in other areas, is incredibly poor. So for example, to date we've had 835 UC claims within Inverclyde, and there's been no uptake in any personal budgeting support by any client within that time period. Obviously that is dealing with a different client group to what we will be moving into when we move into full service. I think my view is there will always be a need for enhanced support for the really vulnerable members of our community.
Ms. McCandy, you wanted to come in on that particular point, or?
Yes, I was just going to make the point about safeguards and how it would be really important, even for new claimants, that there are safeguards in the system, recognising that some people are vulnerable and not everybody has got excellent and good, robust money skills. In Highland, we've supported 225 individuals through the personal budgeting support process, but there is a disconnect between the APA process and the personal budgeting support process. And Andrina referred earlier to making it mandatory. And if we could somehow make that, maybe not mandatory, but if we could insist that individuals who were going through an APA process were offered the choice of PBS as an automatic, not as something that somebody might remember, I think that would help support people better than we are at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Adam Tompkins, did you want to come in? Okay, that's very good. I asked a question at the very beginning, and I'll ask it just now of you. I think most people agreed with the principles of universal credit, but whether you feel in practice universal credit is a positive change for claimants. And, I'll just throw it open to yourselves. Certainly, we've heard lots of different evidence here. I'd just like to have your thoughts on it. Yes or no?
I'll kick off and say, I think, like the first session, it was heard that for a number of people who can deal with the system with either the technology or transiting through universal credit as an interim piece of their life, you know, that it'll benefit a lot of people in that respect, and depending on their employment situations as well with the zero-time contracts and what have you. I have to say that a lot of the people that we're concerned with and the people that we deal with are often at the end that are struggling with it, and it has to support all, I guess, is the key. And so... Yeah, the principles, basic principles, I can understand a lot of them, and they're to be applauded. But in execution, I think is the key. It has to have safeguards within it to support vulnerable people.
Certainly, what we're finding on the ground is for those people who, as John says, have got the ability to conduct their business electronically, they can manage universal credit, and it works well for them. Where they've got variable hour contracts, in particular. Where it's not working is where there's a housing element added into that mix. The housing element really is the challenge in universal credit. That's what we're finding on the ground. And of course, for vulnerable individuals, because under Life Service, it was very managed. It was those newly unemployed, so people who had been in employment, maybe have got more IT skills. Now that we're open under full service, there's real vulnerabilities coming through in terms of numeracy skills, literacy skills, confidence skills, connectivity challenges. You know, you can't get online everywhere in Highland, and that needs to be recognised within the system.
Yep. I would echo my colleagues' comments. I think in principle we would agree universal credit is, you know, was set up for the right reasons. I think it is. I think, as John said, the execution of it, I think the delivery of it, and I think in terms of our really vulnerable clients who, you know, we know a lot of people don't actually turn for help until they hit crisis point, and I think that's really one of the main issues.
Yeah. Would you say that perhaps, and this is probably just the last question, we've went on for extra 10, 15 minutes, people have asked that it be stalled, halted, etc., etc., until all of these issues are resolved. Will these issues ever be resolved when you've got the housing benefit part of it there as well? Would you say that it should be halted or stalled with the difficulties that's coming forward? I won't hold you to it, obviously, basically, but from your professional experience.
From us, with 2 weeks away from universal credit, full service rollout, I think if any of us could hit the pause button within Inverclyde at this point in time, we probably would ask to do so. We have, you know, we're learning as we've gone on. We've listened to our colleagues and the issues that they are having, and we're trying to plan. We have, you know, a very good delivery plan in place for Inverclyde. However, all the problems that have already been alluded to are there. So a pause button at this point would be quite nice.
Sorry, Mr. Cunningham.
I was going to say, after 29 years of essentially being a DWP agent within a local authority delivering housing benefit, I understand how these things happen, and when DWP do introduce things, we've rolled to many changes that have been brought about by the DWP, so I suppose we're pre-wired to make it happen. But, yeah, I think the rate of the rollout could be something that could be looked at, particularly if there are things that are so obviously causing other forms of hardship. And potentially just a look at the client groups that are being involved in it. Yeah.
Ms. Candy.
I would echo that in terms of a pause. I think lessons do need to be learned. I think DWP, they are listening, but they're just not able to keep a pace off their rollout plans, which is published, and learning, and then executing those in terms of improving their software. One of the other challenges is that as local authorities, we're feeding in continuous improvement suggestions. We get no feedback from those suggestions. We don't know what the next authority has put in. So we don't have an overview as a local authority as to what the national picture looks like. DWP assure us they have got an overview of that, but it'd be really helpful if they could share that with local authorities and other partners, because we could help make this a success, because I think eventually it could be successful, but there are a lot of lessons to be learned, and a lot of areas that can be improved significantly.
Thank you very much for that. We'll certainly take that point up, because that did come forward from the trade unions and the workers who are actually, you know, obviously pushing this forward, not pushing it, but having to extrapolate various pieces and deliver it as well. So that's something we will certainly take up with the DWP and perhaps write a letter or speak to them in that respect. Can I just thank you so much for your evidence session. It's been excellent. I think we've all certainly learned a lot, and previous witnesses also. So I'll formally close this meeting and we'll go into private session. Compliments. Thank you.